hedges. We feel a great disruption is ahead.
Our next speaker for this conference is the founder of Schulte Research, set up in 2012, researching financial institutions and financial technology. He has spent 3 decades in research on financials. He has worked for all 3 branches of U.S. government, including the NSC at the White House. He currently teaches in 3 universities, has written 3 books, and authored hundreds of articles. He has worked for the #1 investment bank from the U.S., U.K., Japan, China, and Switzerland, starting in 1990.
He has taught on 4 continents. His focus is technological change in banks and insurance. He has been a source for the Wall Street Journal, the New York Times, Bloomberg, Nikkei, Financial Times, Economist, Barron's, and Forbes. His clients include some of the largest sovereign pension, mutual, and hedge funds globally. And so without further ado, may we please give a warm welcome on stage Dr. Paul Schulte, founder and editor of Schulte Research.
Hi, good afternoon, everybody. I want to try to keep you awake, so they really have to turn down the air conditioning to keep everybody awake here. So I want to talk about this really exciting time in Asia. We wrote a piece, a large piece of research that was about 600 pages last year, and we made a conclusion that Asia was further ahead than China in particular was further ahead in financial technology by at least 1 generation, probably 2 generations in the U.S. And we were lamenting the fact that the major players in the U.S., Apple, Amazon, Microsoft, Google, were virtually absent from financial technology. And a lot of my clients that I met around the world, they said, that can't be right. And I said, tell me what I'm missing. Tell me about Google's payment system. I don't know what it is. Tell me about Amazon's payment system. Amazon is a warehouse. It's an inventory clearance company. You buy things there and they ship it. What's the Amazon financial activity? And a lot of my clients were dumbfounded because these American companies were absent. And I think I concluded that the #1 reason why, can I have my presentation up here so I can start? I think the #1 reason, and I think the correct reason is because they were terrified of the SEC, the U.S. attorney in the Southern District of Manhattan, the district attorney in the Southern District of Manhattan, and the CFTC, and in particular, the Attorney General of California, who has been on a warpath for 8 years, and all these entities administered $350 billion of fines for banks, and many, many prosecutions. And so I think that if you're a board member of one of the technology companies, and you say, let's go into financial services, the answer is going to be, no, let's not go into financial services, because look what's happening in Washington and New York and California. That I believe to be the true and the correct answer, although there's many other extenuating circumstances. In the meantime, Asia had its own financial crisis back in 98. I was working at Credit Suisse at the time, and this was a catastrophe. And I was working in Exchange Square in 1998. You walked around and told somebody you worked for a bank, a taxi driver would spit on you in Hong Kong. And this is what happened in the GFC in the West. In the United States, in the UK, and in Europe, people completely lost confidence in financial institutions, and I believe that confidence has not yet returned. But in the meantime, China never had one of these, and so what you have is a very large population, which was sort of terra incognita, and they could create all these new innovative activities, new innovative technologies that people in China could say, yes, I want this. I will get something in return, and the stuff you get in return on your credit score when you participate in all of the architecture of Tencent and Alibaba is some pretty incredible stuff. And so the people in China, and I believe all the Chinese outside China, and many hundreds of millions who are using these products all over Southeast Asia, and also increasingly in Europe, realize there's a benefit. I get a benefit to showing my information to these companies. This relationship has essentially collapsed in the West. And that's a very big reason why the ecosystem here is so much more vibrant and so much more dynamic and so much more alive. I believe a lot of that comes from the loss of confidence in financial institutions from the GFC in the West. And so with that, I want to talk about today, now what? Now that these financial institutions have firmly established themselves in China, in the last 2 to 3 years, we've seen a tremendous amount of activity leaving outbound China and coming down into Southeast Asia and South Asia. And so I want to include, Bangladesh, Pakistan, India, and then we go to the ASEAN 5, and then we have Vietnam and Myanmar, that's moving all over the place into Australia, and Korea, and even Japan. And so what I'm going to show you today is that we are looking at almost a complete reestablishment of the financial system. I like to think of it as a primordial soup. Everything is being torn down. I think the loss of confidence combined with technology, combined with that terrible chart this morning, that wonderful lady from Citibank, she was great, yeah. It showed the collapse in untrained job creation was in the high negatives in the 20s. And the trained professional job creation was in the plus 20s. And so we're seeing this increasing alienation of untrained workers, which leads to all kinds of problematic populism. When this happens together, we get new types of financial systems, because people are pissed off, they're angry, and I do a lot of work in many universities around the world. I teach in Hangzhou and Hong Kong, Singapore, Tufts University in Boston. I've taught in Rio de Janeiro and in London. And what I see with younger people is they're furious. I always say, I love millennials. Millennials don't know how angry they are. Right? They are furious for being cut out. And they're even more furious because they're leaving universities with negative equity. They're leaving universities with $50,000, $70,000, $90,000 of debt. And they're even more cut out of the pot because they realize how long will it take me to get back at this. When you have this kind of dynamic, you can get a lot of people who are saying, to hell with it, I have nothing to lose, let's go make something. And the technology that we're seeing today is not only on the cheap, it's not only is it free, there is a cost to not using it. Right? So the opportunities here are astounding in terms of the technological innovation, the desperation, and the motivation of younger people who are angry. Anger can motivate you to do a lot of things. Anger is a motivator. And so this is what we're seeing. We're seeing a real revolution. This is exactly what I believe we're seeing today is a revolution. And I believe the cryptocurrency, we talked about this at dinner last night with all of our guests, we talked about this world of cryptocurrencies being a revolutionary movement. I truly believe this is like 1917, that there was something happening, that there is a philosophical movement in the cryptocurrency world. And I believe, I'll go into this in the Q&A if you want, I believe under this is a growing dissatisfaction and intolerance and unacceptability of increasingly being part of SWIFT and the US dollar. So I believe the underlying cryptocurrency phenomenon is saying we want out of SWIFT. We're tired of being dragged along through the cactus patch, being tied to the back of the Federal Reserve Pontiac, and being dragged around and you don't know who the new best friend of the Federal Reserve is going to be, and so the differentiation between New York and Washington is causing people to say, maybe we don't like this anymore. And so I will show you that the one country that is probably further ahead than anybody else in the world, by a large order of magnitude in blockchain and in the cryptocurrency world, is China. And with the One Belt, One Road phenomenon that we're seeing in China, I believe a vitally important part of that One Belt, One Road AIIB phenomenon, and again, as our friend from Citibank this morning mentioned it, China is creating an alternative investment option for the world through One Belt, One Road. And a very important part of that is going to be, I believe, cryptocurrency and blockchain. So I want to go into this, because this is a really important part of what I want to talk about today. So I've been told to aim the clicker over here. It works. Okay, great. First of all, we all know sort of the general view. A lot of people don't realize that the largest diaspora of Chinese is not in Europe, it's not in the U.S., it's in Southeast Asia. So this is the largest diaspora of Chinese in the world. The number of mainland Chinese people in the United States who are there currently living is actually a pretty small number. It's only about 2.5 million. So on top of that, we have indirectly, as you know, from Manila, Bangkok, Hong Kong, Singapore, the amount of mainland Chinese pouring into these cities for tourism is astounding. The numbers that were being given last year are 110 million. When you count mainland Chinese who are having multiple trips, it is 1 billion, right? 1 billion people are traveling out of China, including multiple trips. That number is going to double to around 220 million, which means probably something over to 1.5 billion people making multiple trips to Manila, Bangkok, Jakarta, Singapore, Taipei, and so on. And so this is going to have a big effect. The other great point that our friend from Citibank made that I hadn't been thinking about, the trade tensions are going to start to get really ugly, I believe. And U.S. and European and Asian companies will be forced against their will to have alternative investments in Southeast Asia as a hedge. They're going to have no choice. They're going to have to increase their costs. And so I think that Southeast Asia is going to be a very big winner here, because these companies are going to, BASF, Siemens, GE, are going to have to create alternative bases as a just in case. And so I think that Southeast Asia is going to see another big pouring of investment out of China, which is unfortunate, but I believe this is somewhat unavoidable. Now, I want to talk about what the world of Alibaba, Tencent, Amazon, and Walmart are doing. Because we're going to have a battle royale like you can't believe for the next several years in Southeast Asia. And the what we're seeing in payments right now is sort of the big guys on the left, which is Paytm, which is 250 million payments in India, 250 million people. I grew up in California, and my first bank account was at Bank of America. Bank of America took 70 years to get 20 million, 25 million customers. It took them 70 years. It took Alibaba 2 years to get 250 million customers. This is how rapidly, and part of our primordial soup, what's happening here with a very sudden increase in banking activity because of what technology offers. And I believe that the banks are ignoring this to their profound, disturbing, and very what in the hell is going on here? The banks are asleep. The banks may say they're doing things, but they are not doing anything except stuff at the edges. And we are in year 5 of this. The banks should be way, way ahead on this. HSBC should be way ahead. Standard Chartered should be way ahead. They're not. to me, this is really becoming problematic. Because this battle is going to get really intense. And these guys have their global reputation on the line right now, especially in India. So I want to talk about this first of all. So we have Ant, we have Flipkart, which just became Walmart. And then we have the American firms, which have not even come in yet, and some of the German companies. N26. Anybody, who's ever heard of N26? Raise your hand. One. It is a 10% market share in Germany for lending. It's a 10% market share. Who's ever heard of Credit Karma? Raise your hand. One. Credit Karma is one of the largest modern lenders in the United States. And they're going to start coming out to Asia. Who's ever heard of Cabbage? Cabbage is the largest SME lender in the United States. Did not exist 8 years ago. They're going to start coming out to Asia. And they're going to be getting into bed with some of these guys here. I'm just starting. Now we're going to get to the retail. Because now we have Walmart has just purchased Flipkart in India, which is a $18 billion valuation. And Tokopedia and Lazada was a brilliant acquisition by Alibaba. And Alibaba is more or less 100% controlling interest in both these companies now. And wait till I show you what Tokopedia and Lazada are becoming. They themselves are becoming finance companies. So let's pay attention to that. In the meantime, you have Tiger, you have SoftBank, and you have Temasek. SoftBank and Alibaba are becoming very tight allies. So SoftBank and Alibaba are going at this together against Tencent. And we are finishing a very large, big, fat thumper. So if you want to become a client, let me know. It's a big 200-page thumper. It's a good doorstop. On all of this, I don't think Walmart's going to succeed. I'm skeptical about the larger institutions, larger brick and mortar, because we have an online to offline, and we have an offline to online world. And I wonder if the offline to online is going to work. I wonder, can the brick and mortar guys go into the Barracuda, the Barracuda pit and the alligator pit with these private equity guys? I wonder, are they going to be able to operate very rapidly changing technological systems, which can change overnight and need to be rapidly evolving through a board of directors that are used to making decisions only every 6 months? When some of the times you have to make decisions overnight. I wonder if Walmart's going to be able to pull this off. Walmart has not succeeded in the UK. It closed. It closed in Brazil. It's closing in Japan. It doesn't have a single success anywhere that has expanded except in Mexico. Amazon started as an international company. In Amazon's first year, 50% of its business was international. Amazon is, in its genes, an international company. Very big difference. So I do work with Temasek. I have to disclose that. I work with GIC. GIC keeps everything very secret, but Temasek is really on top of this and is a major player in all of this as well. And so Singapore sees this as a very important strategic investment for this world, and it's part of what Singapore wants to become. So watch that very carefully. Now, here's another weird one, right? When you have a new primordial soup and like things are coming out of the swamp and they have nine eyes and five ears and things die off and then new stuff is born, we're getting all these weird new banks arising out of motorcycle moving companies, right? Motorcycle companies are moving people, they're moving packages, and they're moving food. But in the meantime, they're becoming financial institutions. Very, very quickly. So Gojek did not exist 4 years ago. Gojek now has 12 million bank accounts, right? Did not exist 4 years ago. Gojek is an Indonesian company. I was talking to the gentleman, I was talking to the gentleman from Entrepreneur Magazine, and he was asking me, well, what about the local companies? Well, I said, Gojek is a local company, but Gojek happens to be, have as a major owner, Tencent. So Tencent is moving into these major companies and becoming a $200 million, $500 million partner for companies now. Gojek has a $1 billion valuation. Didn't exist 4 years ago. Anybody who's starting up anything in Manila, you better get a really, really big imagination and think 10 times bigger than you can possibly think today, because that's what's going to happen here. But you guys got to get going quickly in terms of creating something that these other larger players are interested in acquiring, because they will, without a shadow of a doubt. Alibaba is very much absent from this. I am worried about Tencent here because there's going to have to be some consolidation. As you know, Grab now is worth $10 billion. Grab didn't exist 6 years ago. And Grab bought Uber's franchise in Southeast Asia because of a little problem in Indonesia called, you didn't hear it here, Rico. So I've got to go figure out what Rico is. And so the people in Uber made a fortune because they invested $600 million and they made $2.8 billion in the acquisition. And so people are pretty critical of Grab, even though Grab itself now has a $10 billion value. And many people are asking, hey Paul, is Singapore going to let this monopoly dictate Singapore? And I think the answer is you bet. Because Singapore realizes it needs a very heavy hitter in Singapore to compete with these big guys. And so this is something that the Filipino authorities are going to have to think about. They're going to have to allow a large player to be in Manila and may have a very large market share, even though in their regional scope of things, it may be a considerable player. And so the other one, when you look at Grab, you talk to some of these visionary people in Grab. Grab wants to go very much into the SME lending field. Because think of all the information they have. The data they have is incredible. It's three-dimensional data. It's activity, action, movement, payment, everything. So these three-dimensional elements of the world are very, very valuable. They're much more valuable than the one-dimensional world that banks have. Much, much more valuable. And this is why I told one of my clients, one of the big banks in Jakarta, about 6 months ago, use your stock. You are never going to have a higher valuation than you have right now. Use your stock and buy everything in Jakarta right now. Now, of course, the banks are down like 30%. Tough luck. But these banks are trading at 4x book. They could have used their stock and bought Gojek for nothing. But they are just not. Banks lack three things. They lack the structural and even the regulatory ability to collaborate. The structural and the regulatory ability to be imaginative. And the most important of all, when you are doing all of this stuff in innovation, and it's a very big shareholder issue you pointed out this morning, Maria, banks are designed to pay out dividends. If you want to become an innovative company or a technological company, you've got to change your dividend policy and potentially change your shareholder. That's why Amazon is such a success, right? And so the fundamental problem of the telecom companies and the banks is they have a dividend policy which prevents them from being able to invest. Because everybody wants a 4% dividend. And if you want to invest, you can't do that. So there's a fundamental shareholder misalignment right now between banks on top of the regulator. So these two things are holding banks back from being able to do anything. And I think just an inherent nature of conservativeness that a lot of financial institutions have. Here is Tencent now. So here is what we see in Tencent in India, making a lot of smaller acquisitions, in Indonesia with Gojek, in Thailand with Sanook, and another company which I hear is sort of going, meh, sort of okay. Thailand's sort of not great. for Tencent. And then you have C, which has been a huge success for games. And that's kind of, so where is the Filipino company that Tencent needs to acquire in the Philippines? Because they would love to have this as part of their portfolio, right? So get out there and make it, right? And so here is Alibaba. My conclusion, by the way, of my research, which we published on Monday, is Alibaba is kicking ass. It is on top of everything like a cheap suit. Alibaba is way ahead of anybody else in the world, not only in Southeast Asia, but in South Asia. And I believe Alibaba will enter into Bangladesh and Pakistan, and I believe they're going to want to come into the Philippines in a much bigger way. And so if you look at that, you've got Paytm, Tokopedia, Lazada, True Money in Thailand, GCash in Bangladesh. I believe they may be doing another, in Myanmar, and then BCash below in Bangladesh. And doing something much, much bigger. Get out there and let's do something really, really big. Rideshare is such a raw, untapped entity here in the Philippines. Who's going to be the rideshare company for the Philippines, right? And so all we have here is GCash. We also have Singapore Post, which is a very powerful company for logistics and for information on that. And on top of that, most important of all, Alibaba has something nobody else has in Asia, and that's the cloud business. And the cloud business is a vital important part of the business for the One Belt, One Road. And so this is really important. The other guy who's going to be working very closely with this is AWS. Amazon Services is going to compete head-on with Alibaba in the cloud business. Extremely important. And nobody else in Asia has that cloud business right now. And Alibaba, you know, invested $100 million 5 years ago and is really reaping the rewards. It has like an 8% global market share now from nothing only a couple of years ago. So we'll have to see where Alibaba and Amazon go in terms of the cloud. Now here's Alibaba's complete portfolio, which is pretty remarkable. Because my sense is, I think that Alibaba in the Philippines would love to get involved in lifestyle. Food delivery, restaurants, movies, that they really are looking for companies like that. And then in terms of payments, banking, insurance, e-commerce, media, food, lifestyle, logistics, and cloud, Alibaba has the most complete suite of products of any company in the world. And so only Amazon is really only now starting to get a much more complete suite of services on a global basis. Apple is years behind, Microsoft is years behind. Microsoft should be the largest SME lender in the world. It did nothing, it's been asleep for 20 years on this, right? And they're kicking themselves. Amazon should be the largest bank in the world, and they just got into finance 18 months ago on an international basis. And so it's a very exciting time, but God help us if the banks don't wake up, because these financial creatures from the Black Lagoon are coming out of the swamp, and the banks are just sitting there like, you know, frogs on the lily pad, and they're going to get eaten up. And so I really worry about the capacity, especially of the Southeast Asian regional banks, and especially Southeast Asian broker dealers. I'm really worried about the Southeast Asian broker dealers, because these guys are going to get robo advisory. These guys are going to get SME lending. They're going to get high net worth stuff. They're going to get ultra high net worth stuff. They're going to be going into trading for free, trade equities for free, right? And so forth. And bonds, they're going to be able to do bonds. And so you've got Alibaba doing this, Tencent doing this, and you've got Grab morphing very rapidly into a financial institution. he talks a little bit late, the managing director for Grab Finance, and I listened to him in Amsterdam at the Money 2020 conference. He captivated an audience of like 5,000 people on his plan for what they have in mind for Grab Finance. Again, did not exist 4 years ago. So we have so much going on, and it's so exciting. So you guys are not allowed to be afraid. You have to be excited about this. Fear will get us nowhere. Now, look at what's happening with the guys who are Tokopedia, right? Look what else Tokopedia has become, right? Here, you have Tokopedia, which is becoming a trader of gold, vouchers, tax, levies, online loans, electricity bills, insurance, credit cards, loan payment, capital loan, gift cards, mutual funds, right? And then look at what Paytm, I believe, without Alibaba having gotten into Paytm would have died off. So they got a really lucky get out of jail free card, because the 5.0 of Alibaba is Paytm. Paytm is now 5.0 Alibaba, right? This is how important it is. Alibaba's been around 18 years. Alibaba's on 5.0. Many of the banks have not changed their technology in 20 years. This is very problematic. So you look at Paytm, gold, FX, tax, credit card, hot deals, electricity bills, insurance, shipping, tolls, loans, gift cards, mutual funds, right? They're taking that business away from you guys by saying, we're going to do this. We're going to do passive investing. We're going to do mutual fund choices. We're going to do active robo-advice, right? And they're going to have a lot of, they will have almost entirely digital data. And I was thinking a great deal about what you said this morning, Maria, about the human element. Yes, I think it's vital, and I took it on board, and EQ, I think, is key. But I think millennials are going to say, no. Millennials are saying, not so much. I'm okay with the machine telling me what to do, because I don't trust the banks after what they did. Because millennials listened to their parents at the dinner table in 2008, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, bitching about the government, the banks, getting screwed on their mortgage, getting thrown out of their home, nobody went to jail, the banks were bailed out first, I got nothing, and I had a crappy job, and my benefits have been taken away. This is what millennials have grown up listening to at the dinner table. They're not very interested in advice from banks. So this is one of the things you have to pay attention to. So these guys are becoming almost completely digital. And I've talked to a lot of insurance funds at a lot of insurance conferences recently, and I'm so dumbfounded because everyone's talking about, oh, these poor Chinese, you know, they're gonna have to take care of their parents and two sets of grandparents. Crap. These Chinese are gonna inherit $4 trillion in savings. And no one talks about that part. The average millennial right now is around 32 years old and is making around $59,000 at the Far East. This is good purchasing power, man. And these guys are going to inherit a lot of money. And they don't want to talk to a human being. They're okay. Right? And so the millennials are 19 to the 38. And so in this sense, this is a whole generation that if you don't pay attention to that right now, you're dead. And I'm so dumbfounded why insurance companies in particular are even further behind than banks are in terms of understanding and paying attention to and adhering to the needs of millennials, which are very, very different. They're very hopeful, but they're very cynical. And I'm almost astounded. I've been teaching millennials for 19 years, and I'm so struck how optimistic they are, but they have no right to be optimistic. They have every right to be very cynical, and they're not. But they are like very wary, right? And they're not interested in talking to a human being who's over 38 years old from a bank. I can guarantee you that. For a lot of the reasons that we talked about before. So here is an amazing Flipkart, right? So here's your Flipkart world. They have everything. And this is what Walmart just bought into. So Walmart, I suspect, is going to try to use this and branch out into the rest of the Far East. I am a little bit skeptical on this one. I'm not certain about this. I question it. Because I want to see a company that has generated one success after another, and I don't see it with Walmart. UK closed, Japan closed, Brazil closed, right? Mexico, right? And so they just bought a very complex machine in India, which is all locally made. So I wish them the best of luck. I'm not optimistic. Look at that! The Amazon moment for banks has arrived. We compared all of the Amazon products to the Standard Chartered India website. And every single thing that Standard Chartered India currently offers is in the last 18 months being offered by Amazon. This is really problematic because, as you're aware, Amazon is almost a purely digital, pure online, astonishingly easy to use. We all use Amazon, right? And everyone in this room has used Amazon on something. And Standard Chartered technology is, they will admit, it's a client of mine. I work with the executive committee. It's no longer a client. I think I told the truth too much to them. Don't tell the truth. Yeah. And so there is a real crying need to upgrade very, very rapidly. And I've been saying this for so many years, I've stopped saying it because I just feel like there's almost like an inertia, institutional incapability. So God bless the people who come in and create a better product. Better, cheaper, faster, smarter, right, more efficient is what wins the race in this primordial soup. And if Amazon comes along, then it can create Amazon Lending, Vintage, Quicksilver, ThumbTag, Amazon Pay, Amazon Cash, Amazon Prime, Amazon Protect, and Capital Float and Amazon Allowance. More power to you. And if you can do it in a one-stop shop, pure digital, no branches, no humans. Millennials will go for this. One of the really interesting questions that came up when I was at Dublin, at the Money Conference in Dublin, was the guy from Credit Karma. And he was saying, why do, capital cities are very efficient places. Why do they need, like, these kinds of payment systems? And he says, let me show you a slide. And he showed him a slide of all the disbursement. Tens of thousands of data points, people's credit score, and the interest rate they pay on their car, and also the interest rate they pay on their mortgage, and the interest rate they pay on personal loans. There is no relationship in the United States of America, a very developed market, between the rate people pay and their credit score. These markets are so immature, they're so inefficient. We think there's great inefficiency, that is rubbish. Because none of us are probably paying the rate that we deserve from the bank that we go to, or from the leasing company that we go to on our car, or the mortgage rate that we truly deserve on a home. That's not what the banks are in business to do. Banks, they have fees, and they give out okay interest rates. And you have to take it or like it or want it. And so people are saying, no, I don't think I want to do that anymore. So there's a real rebellion going on, and we have to see this in terms of a rebellion. It's very important. So here is now the full suite of stuff that Amazon India did not exist 18 months ago. This is what they now offer, right? Finance, e-commerce, shopping, home services, publishing, insurance, lending, and online payments. Again, brand new. Fairly profound shift in terms of what Amazon was thinking even a couple of years ago. And it's something that we all need to get ready for. And I think that my advice is the quicker you merge with these guys, the better off you are. Because if you think you're going to compete with them, forget it. That's my first bit of advice. And in my last 2 minutes, I can say that the sky's the limit, because there is so much room here for innovation and for technological innovation and things that were virtually impossible to consider 2 years ago, right? And so every 2 or 3 years, we have new evolutions in financial services that were undreamt of 18 months ago. So don't be conventional, be radical. This is a revolution. And you know what someone said, revolutions is when you can walk out on the street and pick up liberty off the floor and run with it. And I believe this is what's happening in the financial services. So pick it up off the street and run with it. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Schulte. Very fascinating talk to me. That is much more effective than coffee, I think, and I agree, at keeping everyone awake. I'm both scared and excited, very millennial. Thank you for the validation. So maybe please ask on stage Mr. Mark Yu, CFA, President and CEO of CNOI Philippines Incorporated, and past president of CFA Society Philippines, to moderate the Q&A session.
Once again, we'd like to remind everyone that to pose your questions, please use the Philippine Investment Conference 2018 conference app. The live Q&A is available through the app. Simply download and install BIC 2018 through the Play Store and Google Play so that you can pose your questions live right now for Mark and Paul. So Mark, please take it away. Thank you.
Thank you, Brad. Can you guys hear me? Okay, I guess before we start, can I just get a show of hands as to how many of you are working in the financial services industry? Okay, so about half of the room. Maybe half the room. It's interesting listening to your session, because I think the key message is the banking industry is getting disrupted. And I'm going to be asking this question later, so you'll have time to think about it. But so half the room you work in, man. When should they start exploring jobs elsewhere?
Oh, I know. I did a presentation about 2.5 years ago to the board, to the son of the founder of UOB in Singapore. And he was there with the board of directors, and there was like 80 people in the back of the room. And my good friend, Ying Lan Tan, who's a brilliant thinker and Sequoia partner, he was there, and he was first up at 9 o'clock in front of the chairman of the company, the son of the founder, the board, and the top 80 people. He said, "Good morning, it's great to be here with you guys. My first bit of advice is, everybody in the back of the room, you 80 people, you need to quit your job right now and go somewhere else and start a financial technology company." And of course, the chairman was going to strangle him. He said, "I'm kidding. I'm not kidding. But here's one thing DBS is doing. DBS is, you need to do this for your company. DBS did something. They said, look at it. We're going to pick 5 people that we think are the most talented people in this bay. We're going to give you a year's leave. And you can come back in 12 months. If you come back in 12 months and you've created something, we get 30%. That will automatically create an atmosphere of innovation in your financial institution. Challenge your best people to say, leave. I promise you, we will give you your job back in 12 months. Go and make something and come back and we will fund it." That's the way you get innovation started, innovative thinking started in a financial institution. If you're not thinking of innovative thinking on every day, Friday afternoon, 4 o'clock, get out the punch, the beer, the pizza. There's no rules. You can say something as stupid as you want. Have a think session every Friday. What did you see out there that we could use inside of our financial institution? Another idea to be started.
So did anyone come back?
I don't know. I don't know what's going on. I'll get back to you on that one. Yeah.
Well, I think that's really interesting.
DBS has become a very big investor in innovative companies. They invested in a lot of startups.
But fundamentally speaking, strategically, you have the banking sort of set of information that they get versus what we have described with payments, retail, rideshare. Is there a way that banks can really compete with the set of information that these guys are getting versus what they have?
Yeah, I know, and it's worse than that because a lot of the technology, you can't, right? It's hard to get that technology and to replicate it in terms of new digital technology because you have to go back and redo everything, number one. Number two, something very problematic. banks then have to digitize paper into a digital format. That will give you new forms of data. Well, it's digitized paper, right? It's paper that's been turned into a digitized thing. That's not, Alibaba's not working on that. Tencent's not working on that. So when you think about what actually they get from digitizing paper, not a hell of a lot. So this is something else that banks have been realizing in the last like 18, 24 months is, are we really getting anywhere? Why don't we just throw away all the paper and start fresh? Or merge with one of these guys?
So let's get a little bit more focused on the different aspects of banking. I'll name here a few. So we have consumer lending, SME lending, private banking, your brokerage, investment banking, personal banking. Among that list, which do you think will get disrupted or is getting really disrupted the most?
So he talked to the head of Cabbage, again, the largest SME lender in the United States. He made a very profound point. In fact, SoftBank just invested $250 million into Cabbage a couple of months ago. He said, it's not that banks don't want to lend to SMEs and individuals. They don't know how. And so the greatest disruption that's coming is the empowerment of hundreds of millions of people who have never been granted access to credit, and tens of millions of SMEs who have been given access to credit. Robinhood has come along. Again, 27-year-old dropout from UCLA, 27 years old, created Robinhood because he was so angry at his broker. So Robinhood has, tens of millions of users right now. Robinhood is totally disrupting the broker-dealer. I will tell you this, I came from that side of research in banks. Mark my words, in 2 years, sales, trading, and research, that function will be gone in 2 years. So that's going to be profoundly disruptive. Get data analytics, get big data, get drone technology, get technology that can help your clients. Drop the analysts. And this is where the CFA really has to change, and I'm so glad that the CFA has incorporated blockchain and cryptocurrency stuff. But I think I've worked with the CFA in Hong Kong and China, and I've also spoken to a big conference last year in the Middle East. The CFA's got to move much, much faster in terms of changing the examination questions to incorporate a lot more of this.
Great, thank you for that. So I guess who here are analysts? who here have a startup or are working in a startup? I guess you guys can exchange business cards after. So I think the answer there was really SME consumer lending. So that's really the asset side of the balance sheet for capital security. When do you see the liability side really being disrupted? Deposits. I know it's an Amazon. I mean, they had personal banking, payroll banking. I was actually surprised even in private banking.
Yeah, that's a great question. I think it'll take longer. I mean, that deposit side is very sticky, as bankers know. That's what keeps banks in business. But on the margin, I think the largest marginal lenders in the UK is Zopa, right? The largest marginal lenders in the US are these kinds of companies. Most of the lending for this is going to be securitized lending, right? So the liability side of the balance sheet is going to be securitization. Like SoFi, $5 billion balance sheet, it's very much a securitized liability structure, right? And Cabbage is a securitized liability structure. But what's happening is, don't forget what happened with Alibaba. Alibaba just started this. Alibaba became the largest money market fund in the world in like 2 years. So don't be too comfortable with your deposit structure, because Alibaba became larger than PIMCO in 2.5 years.
I guess it's something to think about. I mean, if your liability side of the balance sheet gets squeezed, then I think it also has an effect on the asset side.
Yeah.
We have time for two more questions, so I'll read one from the audience. So we've been talking about banks getting disrupted, and you mentioned there that there's any sort of payment going to banking, etc. Of all the industry entry points into finance, ride sharing, retail, logistics, food delivery, which one has seen the most success and speed in leveraging their business platform to finance? And I'll add to that, which one do you think will eventually win it all? Is there a win it all sort of space here, or do you see this with a different platform sharing?
I guess that that is the question. That's the million-dollar question. I'll take a stab. I believe Alibaba will win. They're so smart. I think Tencent has really shot itself in the foot by a string of disastrous IPOs this year. It's embarrassed itself with six terrible IPOs. WeChat is also a fascinating contender. I think Amazon also is probably transforming itself only in the last 18 months, faster than Alibaba did, you know, 7 years ago. So don't count Amazon out yet. I think Amazon could be very interesting here as well.
Looks like we have one more question. You mentioned earlier that Singapore, for example, there's sort of regular protective effort. How does, I guess, a nation evolve towards having that mindset? Like, is the Philippines, do you think something, how do we spur our regulators to actually protect innovations in the country?
That's another great question. Look, you know, Alibaba is China Inc. man. You know, this is like the 1950s. The 1950s and 60s, you had Citibank, you had Bank of America, and you had Chase Bank. Chase Bank was the bank for the CIA. Citibank and Bank of America were the ones who went out into the rest of the world. They followed corporates. A lot of this was organized through Washington, D.C. This is nation building. China is nation building, and China is going to create, through the AIIB, an equivalent of the World Bank, the IMF, the Export-Import Bank, and OPEC, all together in one. And Alibaba Cloud, the Ali Cloud, is going to be one of the main mechanisms, Huawei and Tencent. These guys are national assets. Let's not kid ourselves. And I think Grab is something kind of like a little bit of a sort of national asset too. And I think Singapore is very okay with having a very heavy hitter incorporated in Singapore, run by Singaporeans. That's a major player. I think they're very okay with that. But these are all, you know, great questions. We can go on and on for a long time. These are really like, really get to the nub of the issue. I think blockchain, my last comment is, I think blockchain is going to, in the next 5 to 7 years, is going to make us all rethink what the nation state is. It's going to really make us all rethink that. And regulators have to be aware of this and think about these issues.
Thank you for that. I just saw a few people walk out the door and they're doing a good job. So. Yeah. All right, thank you again.
Thank you very much. Dr. Paul Schulte and Mr. Parkey, round of applause. Awarding of plaques and tokens, and then a quick photo opportunity with Mr. John Dong, our official photographer. May we please have on stage Ms. Christina Arceo, CFA, our president of the CFA Society of Philippines.